Welcome to this hour where we're basically going to be talking about a fascinating subject, which is yoga injuries and how to prevent them. I want to introduce myself first and then pass the microphone to my dear friend Andrea. My name is Adrian Molina. I am the founder of the Warrior Flow School, and we offer a 200-hour yoga teacher training that is trauma-informed, accessible, and adaptive. And in a couple of weeks from now, we'll be releasing our first standalone anatomy training with our dear friend Andrea. So today serves as an opportunity for you to learn how we are approaching anatomy these days, in the ways that learning anatomy can help us prevent injuries. And towards the end of the session, we'll also exploring what are the most common postures that can be some of those that cause more injuries or potentially causing injuries. And Andrea will be breaking down those postures as well. Andrea is a dear friend of mine. I think we know each other for more than 20 years. We have worked together, done trainings together. So it's a pleasure to be able to have her as part of the faculty of the Warrior Flow School. So I'm going to pass the microphone to Andrea. I'm going to be kind of the moderator, looking at the chat and all of that. So thank you. Thank you, everyone, for being here. And hello, Andrea.
Hi, Adrian. Thank you, everyone. I'm so happy to be here, and lots of kind of familiar faces and names. Hi, Marissa. Nice to see you. And Anita. And then new names, new faces that I've not met yet and hope to soon or will at some point down the road. So first of all, let me say I'm really excited to be here. I'm incredibly honored to be part of the Warrior Flow Teacher Training faculty. I have being a little bit behind the scenes for the last couple of years. So I know how hard Adrian and Jeremy and team have been working. And even then before that, I went during the pandemic, Adrian and team were such a force of community online. And I think that has just carried over into our post-pandemic world beautifully. So thank you, Adrian, for the opportunity to be here and the opportunity to learn and to grow and to teach more, which are all the things that I love to do. As some of you know, particularly about anatomy, which I absolutely geek out on. But for those of you that don't know me yet, I am Andrea Borrero. I'm a yoga teacher. I am a health and wellness and nutrition coach. And I'm also a health and wellness nutrition coach through Institute for Integrative Nutrition. And then a personal trainer, nutrition coach, and functional movement teacher through NASM, right, which is the National Academy of Sports and Medicine. So my love affair of anatomy started a long time ago with yoga, which is why it's such a special space for me. But as I study more, it takes me into other areas, and my world has broadened. I'm based in New York City. I've been teaching for yoga for about 15 years and doing all the other bits and pieces I just mentioned for about 3 years, and hoping to expand and move in that direction as I grow. I've had the great honor of studying with some amazing anatomy teachers in the movement world, and I highly recommend you all studying with them, whether you're a movement specialist or just somebody that is curious. So Kristen Leal was my first anatomy teacher. Jill Miller is an incredible teacher that I've had the great honor of studying at through the years. Tom Myers, who is just also amazing. I mean, I'm going to keep saying the word amazing. You know, I've been able to study online with him and his team and do some dissection work. And then, of course, if you've never had the chance to kind of to study with Gil Headley on his online universe, I highly recommend it. So I continue to learn and grow, and these teachers have all been great influences on me. And I want to be that force for good in the world, as well as encourage you all to continue your studies past whatever interest, or in pursuit of whatever interest you have. So,
Andrea,
let
me ask you something, because sorry, I'm getting excited looking at the chat, all the different places where people are tuning in today. So yeah. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for those of you who are just tuning in last minute. Andrea, you have such a unique way of teaching anatomy that as a student of yours for many, many, many years, it's not the normal situation to learn anatomy in the way that you teach it. Can you talk a little bit about why is it that every time that we do an anatomy training, people are kind of blown away by the fact that you basically bring anatomy to another dimension? What is it, that dimension, that you tap into it with your teaching?
Well, besides the fact that I get really excited and geek out on it, which I think comes through in a couple of funny ways, everybody that's studied with me on this call knows that for sure. It's not just the cats, although I feel like the cats are a big part of it, but not always. But in all seriousness, I think one of the things that I really honestly believe, and all of the teachers that I just named helped encourage me in that direction in terms of how I developed my own personal style, but I believe that, you know, our relationship with our body is one of the most important that we're ever going to have. We can't really escape it, right? It's right there every day when we wake up and when we go to sleep. And I think it's an intimate relationship. And so I think, and I feel that it's like any other relationship that you want to keep healthy and functioning in your life, you have to have this continuous dialogue with it. And for me, anatomy is a way of having that dialogue. It's a way of sharing a common language. And any intimate relationship that you're trying to expand or heal or go deeper with, it's about active listening and dialogue, right? And reflective dialogue coming back to you. So that language, that common language between us and our bodies, is anatomy. Learning anatomy, whether you are a movement teacher or a mover or just curious about it, it's about building that relationship and learning a common language. And I also, that leads to this idea that there's two bodies, right? There's the body that we think about, and that's the body that's been given to us by modern medicine, by healthcare, by pop culture, by social media. This is the body that we think about outside of ourselves, and we often identify with, which is not a bad thing. But there's also the body we live in. There's the body that we experience. And that's the one that is there. There is no kind of reflection back to us on the body that we live in. We're all having this unique experience based on our lives, our histories, our traumas, our injuries, our emotions. Right? Every single body, we come from the same blueprint and template, but we're all having a very different experience. And that's where things get a little murky, because it can often be an inarticulate experience. And I believe that language, anatomy gives us that language to start bringing those two bodies closer together, right? So there's the body that we think about and the body that we live in, and there's the gray area between the two that belongs to us. And I believe anatomy is important to learn as a science and as a clinical and intellectual endeavor, but I also believe that it helps us articulate more what's happening in our bodies and creating that unique and intimate experience. And that's how I teach anatomy to anatomy students. It's also how I, when I'm teaching a group class or a one-on-one and dealing with looking at, you know, a particular body in front of me, I always come from the stance of this is somebody that's having a unique experience. It's like that famous quote, right? You be kind because you never know what people are going through. I think it's the same for movement, right? We never know what somebody is having, that particular experience they're having in their body. So I believe that anatomy also gives us a platform to build empathy and grace for ourselves as well as for other people out in the world. And we're all movers, right? So regardless of age, ability, range, injury, we are all born as movers to some capacity.
So I guess basically what we're saying is that for those of us who are not that young, we're just learning a different way to approach anatomy, right? We remember the old anatomy book. Andrea, and how is it that learning anatomy this way can actually help us to to prevent injuries? And before you answer that, I just want to mention everyone, I just typed it on the chat. There will be some time at the end of this hour to answer as many questions as we can. So if you can save the questions towards the end of the practice, type them on the chat if it makes it easier. And hopefully as we go through this workshop, Andrea will be answering some of those questions.
To your question, I think, Adrian, which was what, in terms of how does studying anatomy help us kind of manage injuries? Again, it's this body we think about, right? So if we start to learn, we all come from a blueprint and we anatomically do essentially the same things. Our joints work more or less the same way. There are rules and regulations. There are jobs and duties for the joints, the muscles, bones, right? And so learning what things do, what they're responsible for, how they interact, the kinetic chain and how that works, which is something we talk a lot about in the anatomy course, so how the whole kinetic chain of the body interacts with itself. The more we understand the rules and regulations, we learn that our knee, for instance, is only supposed to flex and bend, flex and extend, right? It only has about, let's say 5% of rotational ability. And that rotational ability is really just there to pick up and absorb shock or movement that might be coming from the hip. But the knee is not meant to twist. In any scenario, is it meant to fully twist, right? It has two jobs, flexion and extension. And the job of the joint is to articulate the bones, and the job of the muscles is to move the joint, to move the joint in different shapes. So if we know those essential rules of how things are supposed to work, and then we can begin to apply that what's going on in our body, right? The body that we live in, how do we feel? And then how can we take that knowledge lens and place it over how we feel? And there is a little, so often how we feel is based on emotional connections to our body. But if we can start to step back a little bit and witness ourselves as a mover and a inhabitant of our own lives and bodies, and are in this relationship, you can start to also, I believe, move better and move more mindfully, and therefore prevent injury if there's a precondition for injury, and or heal injury if there's an imbalance in the body, a muscular or skeletal or even neuromuscular imbalance in the body that can then lead, that needs help kind of reintegrating into the world. So having this knowledge base allows us to be better movers, smarter movers. And I just said this to a client of mine the other day. It's not so much about getting stronger and getting fitter. It's about being smarter movers. It's about kind of being inhabiting your body in the moments that it's taking action and doing things. And that's how I think we prevent injury in all sorts of scenarios, whether it's in our knee, our shoulder, our hips, our spine.
You know what I'm thinking, Andrea? I'm thinking, just want to share a personal experience. When I finished my first 200-hour teacher training, this was 2004, I finished the teacher training and I didn't feel that I knew anything about anatomy. So if we go back, and you remember this because that's when about the time that we met, on the early 2000s, the assumption was that every yoga teacher should be doing adjustments and touching and helping and correcting and assisting and all of that. And as the time went by, we realized that perhaps the touch part, it is important, but not as important. However, the understanding of anatomy is incredibly helpful to understand our movements. And the point that I was wanting to mention is not only in helpful in prevention of injuries, but in the sustainability of our practice. That's my dog, Buddha. So do you have any thoughts about sustainability and anatomy?
Sustainability in the practice through the study of anatomy, in other words? Yes. Yeah, I mean, I think it goes back to what I just said, but not in an intellectual way. I believe as we build our own practices and we become more familiar, we have to go back to this idea that it's a conversation that we're having with our body every single time we move. And we ignore what the body is saying, right, at our own peril. It's just like, you know, when you're in an intimate relationship and your partner is saying something and you're like, oh, I'm thinking about what to have for dinner or what I'm going to watch on Netflix. And then all of a sudden they're like, right, you agree? And you're like, oh boy, I got to backtrack here. What did I just agree to or not? So it becomes that conversation where we're going off on our own tangent while our body's doing movements. And I see this a lot in my own classes, group classes, and with private clients, which is that they're moving, but they're not in their bodies. right? I can see they're miles away and they are thinking about something and they're just kind of raising their arm and putting it up and stepping or doing. The conversation that we are having with our body is constant. It is kinetic. It is subtle. It is nuanced. And in order to create a sustainable body to live in, we have to listen to what the body is saying. And, you know, there's another famous quote out there where that says the body that heals you is also the one that makes you sick, right? I think, in fact, Dee, who's on this call somewhere, brought that up one time during one of our sessions in our first cohort, that this body is one and the same. So in terms of sustainability, we have to take ownership of our own movement and our own practice as yoga practitioners and any other movement that we're doing. We become our own advocates in movement by having this very deep conversation. And that includes if you're in a class and an adjustment doesn't feel good from a teacher, speaking up, reminding teachers what your injuries are or not, or how you'd prefer to practice. And, you know, by extension, by kind of the vice versa of that is that sometimes adjustments can be really helpful in reminding you how you move, right? There's this idea of proprioception, kind of knowing where we are in time and space, and that the more we get how our body is moving in that time and space place, the more connected we get, the more we're able to refine movement, feel how things are actually taking us, happening in the moment. And that takes us into interoception, right? Which is, I know, an area of study for you, Adrian, which is like we can almost start to feel on an internal basis, an internal level, how the muscles are moving and what's happening in the organs and the breath, right? We become ever more perceptive to what's happening in our own body. And I think that is something, if we want to tie it back to the yoga tradition, is very palpable. The ancient yogis just kind of were in their bodies and experienced their body at that very micro level.
I think and you just, Andrea, you took it to another level because it's the first time that my mind went bananas for a moment. So did I just understood this for the first time that anatomy is a way of mindfulness?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
But again, we can't become too attached to the idea of what are the names of the muscles, what are the names of the bones. Like that happens a lot, right? I think when we first study, and I was that person when I first studied anatomy, I wanted to know all the muscles and where they were and how things work. And then I started doing a little bit more fascial study, and I was like, well, it doesn't actually really matter where all the muscles are and what they're called. I mean, it does, but we're all one big muscle anyway. And how does fascia start to play with movement? So you can get lost in the forest of anatomy terms and techniques and clinical ideas, and that's not a bad thing, but it will take you outside of your body. And that's, I'm more interested in how do these things come back together. And that's where, again, the value of our own personal experience in our own personal bodies, in our own bodies, is incredibly important. And I think as a culture, it's devalued because we put a lot of our faith in medicine, modern medicine, and in healthcare. And again, modern medicine is not the bad guy here. It's just that we also have lost the connectedness to our own body and what it tells us, right? What it's capable of telling us and communicating to us in that conversation and that relationship. And so anatomy study combined with that intense mindfulness of the body you live in, I think then absolutely becomes a mindful practice. And I think that's how we can tap into our intuition and our empathy for others. That's all ingrained. It's written into our coding, the coding of our bodies. And that's just our anatomy, right? That is the blood and the flesh animated, the spark that yoga talks about. So how do we build that? And I can say, just kind of talking back to my own personal experience, I mentioned all these teachers that I studied with, you know, and I had done yoga for a while before I actually did my first yoga teacher training and started studying anatomy. And so I had yoga really shifted things for me. But once I started anatomy, that conversation with my own body began. It's like day one was when I was 37 years old. I was like, oh my God, things make sense all of a sudden. And that began a very personal healing journey and intensified my love for anatomy as really this kind of, it's almost like it kind of uncovers the poetry of the universe. If you want to really go into the mystical realms, it uncovers that kind of, you know, if you think Adrian and I were talking about the matrix earlier this morning as we prepared for this, but if you think about, you know, in computer coding, it's just to the layman, it looks like zeros and ones, but in reality it is, you know, when somebody can make sense of that language, it really becomes this beautiful thing that we have available to us. I feel the same way about anatomy. It's kind of a way of making the blur of zeros and ones in the universe make a little bit more sense in these amazing bodies that we have.
It makes a lot of sense. Now, I was wondering, because I know we have something special for everyone here on the call, if we can go over some of those postures that we might find to be kind of challenging when it comes to anatomy, and if we can tap into that, because I think that's the fun part of anatomy, actually seeing it in action.
100%. I think part of this responsibility for our own bodies and mindfulness, this intimate relationship we have, is keeping in mind that we take yoga classes, for instance, that there are a lot of poses that are ubiquitous that come up a lot in different classes. And once we start this journey of taking responsibility for our own anatomy and the mindful way of moving, there's things to keep in mind. Like there's rules and regulations, to keep in mind. And therefore, when you're in a class and when a teacher is cueing, you still have the responsibility of your own body to listen to. So that's where I came up with, well, I didn't come up with it. I mean, I call it the tricky six. And it really came out of this idea of when I was studying nutrition, they talk about the dirty dozen, which are the 12 vegetables or plants that have the most pesticides. So this is these poses are in no way toxic. So it's not apples to oranges, so to speak. But it is this idea that these poses come up a lot, and they're often, you would think they are beginner's poses, and they're actually not. And there's things to watch out for and things to be mindful of in your own body. And remember what I said back at the beginning, I think the best yoga in itself does not cause injury. Mindless moving in the yoga space, or having somebody lead you in a mindless way in the yoga space can cause injury, or it can cause a precondition to manifest into an injury. And again, we're all walking into these spaces with different things going on in our bodies. And so it comes back to that idea of taking ownership and responsibility, and working with teachers that you trust, and knowing the rules, right? The body you think about, taking it into the practice.
I like what you're saying. And also it makes me think of, and again, I always like to come back to the topic of sustainability, because for those of us who've been practicing for a while, and I know that we have friends and students joining today who they've been practicing even longer than you and I, Andrea, and the importance of wear and tear and the importance of adjusting the practice accordingly to the phase of your life that you're going through, so the practice can become something that you can do forever or as long as you can, instead of, for lack of a better word, ignorance or not knowing, doing things that might actually be not playing on your favor on your body. So I think it's very interesting to see anatomy also through the lens of sustainability, and how through anatomy and understanding movement, which is what you do and what you teach, we can all adapt our practice. And we're always adapting. That's the thing. We're always changing.
We're always changing, and we're always, I say this to all my students, I'm sure a couple of people have heard it that are in this space right now, is that our body, all our body wants to do is help us. It wants us It wants to keep us alive. It wants to heal us. There are healing systems that are encoded into our body. It wants to help us get through our day as best we can. And that's where that relationship piece, our responsibility then back to the body is to listen to it, to help it do its job, to move mindfully, to rest, to drink water, to do all the things that help it. So that's that kind of codependency. You know, again, not in a toxic way, but the relationship is allows us to move to create bodies that we can grow old in, right? And that means something different for each of us. I kind of want to, before we move on to the, what we talked about, Adrian, the this applies to, you know, and the great thing that Warrior Flow is doing is this idea of adaptive yoga, that we are in different bodies having different experiences and different levels of, you know, ability, quote unquote. So I want to make clear that that applies to anyone and everyone, this idea of the body we live in, creating the most sustainable, best version of the most mindful, most sustained version of ourselves as we move forward. So it doesn't mean doing the fancy yoga tricks. It could, but it doesn't have to. It might just mean walking better, or you know, being able to stack your joints and do a half push-up, or finally feel your core for the first time and understand what that is. So it means something different for each of us.
Yeah. And I think those are elements that sometimes the mainstream yoga, just to put some name to it, we kind of ignore. How important it is balance for everyone, regardless how young or old you are, how important it is. And sometimes we go through a full yoga class and we don't address those things, joints, balance, you know. I think it's such a wonderful topic, the one that we're diving in today, not only because nobody wants to get injured through yoga, but also to understand that there is so much more than a choreography, a movement, or postures or sequences. And ultimately, you know, all yoga, I think, has as its center connection. And what a, like you said, what a, is there any other connection, essential connection, more important than connecting to yourself in order to be able to reach out to others? So even through the anatomy lens, we can draw those parallels, which is very interesting to me.
Absolutely. I mean, I think, again, that first kind of line of anatomy, what we do with our students is that they learn it in themselves first. And they embody it and they start to feel it in a new way. And that, I strongly believe, creates empathy for other people. And you may not know exactly what someone is dealing with, but you can start to have an understanding of what the value of movement and sustainability means for that other person and how it can improve their life in one way or another.
So I'm ready here. I'm just waiting. I'll be the student today and you tell me
okay.
What to
do. Yeah. So what we're going to do is something that we talk about in the anatomy movement course, or something I talk about in the anatomy movement course, but this idea of the tricky six. And again, they're not tricky to do. It's not like we're doing one-handed handstands or anything crazy. It's more about these poses that show up that are ubiquitous in public yoga classes, group yoga classes, and the more modern contemporary view of yoga. And what I mean by tricky is that they may look simple, or they may be fairly, you may see them fairly often, but there's some things to remember about them as both teachers and movers and practitioners. So the first one we're going to talk about, and Adrian is kind enough to demo for me so you have a visual instead of slides. So the first one that I want to talk about is Tadasana. Can I take myself off of spotlight and just have you be the body? So. There's more. Okay. Well, I don't think it's mine.
Yeah, it's in my feet.
Yeah. Let me just remove my own spotlight. There you are. Okay. And Buddha is still in frame. So that works really well. So the first one is Tadasana. And in the most, you know, this is mountain pose in a lot of traditions. And Tadasana is really, you know, it's the stacking of the joints from the feet on up. In my anatomy course, we talk a lot about the kinetic chain and the five kinetic checkpoints, and that really are foot and ankles, knees, hips, shoulders, head and neck. Right? So these are areas in each body that we can see. So So mountain pose is the easiest way to see all of them, but I also want you to keep in mind that mountain pose can happen, in all, pretty much happens in all poses, whether it's in, you know, the top body or the bottom body, or in an asymmetrical way between the front, between the top and the bottom parts of the body. But we're still looking for an essential joint stacking that brings equilibrium. So the one thing about Sanasana that I want you to remember, whether it's in this mountain pose or whether it's in a seated pose, right, Dandasana, which is legs down, legs on the ground, is that the four curves, and maybe you can turn for a lateral view, a side view of Adrian so they can see the side view, is that we want to maintain the four curves of the spine. Yeah. And you can see, I mean, Adrian is very strong, but you can see he has a natural flow to the four curves of his spine. You know, up at the top, he has the cervical and then the thoracic and then the lumbar, which is his low back, and then the sacral, which is kind of tapers off into his tailbone. So his four curves for us to have a straight spine are what when we say straight spine, what we really mean is that the natural curvature of those four curves are in place. And that's where we're able to move from with a sense of equilibrium in Tadasana. And what we want to do is maintain those four curves in Tadasana. So we don't want to flatten any of them. We want them to stay in their beautiful natural state. Sometimes when we're in mountain pose, somebody may give the cue, or we may think that we have to kind of push our chest out and squeeze our shoulder blades together. Can you do that for a moment? Carefully and gently, of course. But what that can do is that can flatten the thoracic curve, right? Which really then takes him slightly off balance from his center of gravity. And also sometimes we'll have this cue where we'll have this mental picture of tucking our tailbones between our legs. And if you over tuck, you can see there, it flattens the lumbar curve of his spine. And that too can take the whole curvature, the whole delicate balance of the spine off balance. Now, in and of themselves, these cues are not wrong. They're trying to achieve something. But you as the practitioner and the mover bear a responsibility to understand how things are feeling in your body and what may be happening. So it's just about maintaining those four curves in Tadasana wherever and whenever you see Tadasana show up. And another important thing to remember, and we do this in that movement course when we talk about anatomy of breath, is that the diaphragm, which is your major muscle of respiration, it has attachments, it has fascial connective attachments to the vertebrae of the lumbar spine. So if we flatten the lumbar spine, we can directly, or indirectly, I should say, affect how well we breathe. So there's just, if the only thing you remember is maintain the natural curve of the spine, that's what I want you to remember about Tadasana, so that then the stability in the pose comes about just a gentle engagement in your abdominals and a stacking of the joints the way Adrian has it here. Okay. The next one that I wanted to talk about, and this is arms overhead. Adrian, I don't know if you can do this easily. Yeah, exactly. I was going to say, take it down a level. And arms overhead really, arms up, appears in a number of poses, right? Like warrior one, Urdhva Hastasana, which is our upward salute, high lunge, chair pose, Utkatasana. So it shows up a lot of the time. And what we're doing is we're reaching up, right? The joint of the shoulder is kind of rotating up, the arms are in flexion. But the thing to remember here is that sometimes we'll reach up and then our shoulders will really, really climb. And then we try to drag the shoulders down. And then we try to reach up. And then we try to drag our shoulders down. When we reach our arms up, there's a couple of joints that are working. Right. But the one that I want you to think about is essentially your shoulder blades, right? And what they do when we reach our arms up, they upwardly rotate. So the way the shoulder girdle is designed is that the scapula and the arm bone are connected and they always pretty much move together, right? And those shoulder blades on the back of your body allow for freedom of movement with stability in the arm. So if we want to reach for something, or say the sky, we don't want to actually drag our shoulders down because it's counterintuitive anatomically. Our shoulder blades are tilted up or upwardly tilting and elevating. But if we say drag your shoulders down, then they have to come down and I lose the reach of my arm. So what you want to do is kind of find the space in your own body, which might mean arms wider, elbows bent, or even hands at waist that keeps this from getting too intense, right? Because, and you also don't want to counteract something with a abrupt movement, right? We don't want to forcefully drag the shoulders down the back. We just want to soften. It's always about finding equilibrium, right? That sense of grace and softness in a pose, where we can experience it without hurting ourselves. So we want that softness here, which may mean that you don't get your biggest, bestest, superheroist reach in that moment, right? Okay, thank you. And so again, that natural action is the upward rotation. We want to honor the way the body works anatomically. And that's where learning the rules and regulations helps, right? Because once you start to know how things move, you can start to adjust in your own body, modify your own actions, right? All right, next thing we're going to talk about is forward folds. And forward folds can really happen standing or seated, right? The idea is the same. So in our forward folds, a couple key things to remember. Our hamstrings, which are the muscle group on the back of our legs, Adrian is pointing, these are extensors, like these are major extensors of the hip. And they connect at various points on our pelvis, right? And our pelvic girdle. And they, when we, and the low back muscles have similar attachments. So when we take a forward fold and we feel the stretch in the low back, it's not a bad thing, but sometimes what people do is they hyperextend the knees and they really feel like they have to overstraighten the knees here to get a big hamstring stretch on top of that. So a couple things to remember. You can choose the back stretch over the hamstring stretch, because I promise you the hamstrings are getting stretched. Or you can focus on the hamstring stretch, but you still want the knees to be soft, right? We want to have muscle stretch in the belly of the muscle, right? The midsection of the fibers, not at the attachments. And our hamstrings attach underneath on our butt, on our pelvis, and at the knee, right? So neither of those places do we want to stretch them. So the stretch comes from a little bend in the knee and a shift of the weight forward and an isometric, kind of a hugging in of the leg and then a tipping up of the sit bone, gentle up. Okay. So see how Adrian's doing that? And there's not, he's still keeping that micro bend in his knee without over straightening it. Adrian, can you, without injuring yourself, hyperextend your knees as if you were forcing a hamstring stretch? Yeah, but see what shifts here? He has to lengthen then in the back and turn on his muscles again. And all of his weight went back into his heels. But when he softens and turns on the muscles and then shifts forward, that's where the stretch comes from. So there is this illusion out there that we need, for the hamstrings to get stretched, we need to be super straight in our legs. The only caveat I will just say to that is that some people are super flexible and they can get their knee a little straighter, right? But they still need to turn on the muscles and have the stretch come from the belly of the hamstring, not from where it attaches on the knee, the pelvis. So those forward fend things to remember in your forward fold are important whether you're seated or standing. And then last but not least, making sure that you come out or come in with bent knees. Right? So if you bend your knees a little here and bring your hands to your waist, Adrian, and then come on up to stand and come all the way up. Yeah. And then coming down, which you don't have to do, with knees slightly bent, again, taps you into what's going on in your body and how that might feel. And so if you already have a low back injury or a tight low back or precondition or stenosis happening in the low back, things that can really compromise range of motion, you want to come in and out of forward folds with knees bent, regardless of how your hamstrings feel or your back feels, right? It's the way the body works that we want to protect those areas. So forward folds, another thing that seems relatively easy, but don't force yourself into hamstring stretches. I don't like saying the word don't, because we all do these. I still do things that I'm like, oh, I shouldn't do it. Do your best not to hyperextend knees and forward folds. Be mindful of turning on the muscles, whether you're seated or standing, and proceed with caution, right? Remember that the stretch is happening in the center and the belly of the muscle, not at the attachment. Okay, so, and if you get a hamstring injury, which is where we have a tear or a strain at the attachment, it's a really tough one to come back from. It just takes a long time. So you want to avoid any hamstring injuries if possible. Okay. So those are the first three, Tadasana, arms up, and then forward fold. Downward facing dog is another one that I think bears looking. And there's a lot here. We could spend probably an hour or two on down dog and not get to it all. But a couple of things to keep in mind. Some of the more traditional practices will say gaze at your navel in down dog. In and of itself, not a bad cue. But what it does is if somebody overdoes it, like the way Adrian's exaggerating, you can compromise the vertebrae of the cervical spine. And that can, if there's a precondition or an injury farther down the kinetic chain, it could manifest or hurt the cervical spine. Again, similar, remember what I said about Tadasana being everywhere, you know, there should be a little of Tadasana in Adrian's upper body and lower body, right? So there's still some, I would even have him bend his knees a little more, compress his hips back, and I get a little bit more of that thoracic curve. There's the natural curves of the spine, and mountain pose or Tadasana in the bottom legs, where a little bit of that softness in the knees may help his hamstrings from overstretching. So that's one. The other thing is, and allowing the neck, I should say, to gently release with be in line with the spine. I think it's more important to isometrically hug or stabilize the inner arms towards one another and allow your neck to lay in line with your spine, more or less. The other thing that I think is important in downward facing dog is that you can come down anytime, Adrian, if you get tired. We all have different structures, right? I mentioned we have the same blueprint, but sometimes there's different shapes and bones. The joints, you know, anatomically come together in a slightly different way. So it's remembering in down dog, not just for yourself, but if you are a teacher, the arms could be a little bit wider if somebody has what we call a carrying angle, which is where, I can't even show you on my elbow, but the elbow has a natural in the carrying angle. The elbow would kind of go out a little bit more than, so it looks like it's out of alignment with the shoulder and the wrist. But for that person, it's entirely normal and it's structural. So for that person, they might want to take their arms a little wider. Normally, I cue wrist creases to the top edge of the mat so that you can spread the fingers and reach all the way through the hands. Somebody with very narrow shoulders might be more comfortable with the arms slightly wider and the fingers spread out a bit more. So you have to account for the fact that people have different structural issues in their shoulder girdle and their arms. There's also different what we call pronation angles, right? So when I supinate and pronate my hands, my forearms, there might be a different degree of rotation. And that will affect, you know, essentially when you're in down dog, your forearm is in pronation. And that may affect how intensely that's happening in your shoulder, because it's going to force some rotation in your shoulder if you have a very acute angle. So you would then need to separate the arms. So again, a pose that looks kind of relatively docile, a lot going on, and we're not even talking about the pelvis. We don't have time, but you just have to be mindful for your own body as a practitioner and a mover, what's going on and how things may adjust. And you may want to opt out of down dog. It's a big, intense pose for a lot of people. Thank you, Adrian, for that. There's a lot of time in down dog. The other thing, tabletop, plank, and chaturanga dandasana, which are all, again, very common in vinyasa classes. I teach them. And they're all of a kind. They all kind of sit in the same family. Tabletop, a wonderful pose, I believe, with many applications. And again, Tadasana in the upper back, right in the spine. He has a nice kind of, he's not flattening his lumbar spine by over tucking his tail. and he's not over protracting his shoulder blades by really pushing too hard on his arms. But he's got a beautiful sense of equilibrium here. But again, I would be mindful of a couple things. Wrist creases parallel to the top edge of the mat or slightly out. The isometric stabilization of his arms, meaning hugging his inner arms together without actually having them go anywhere, and pressing the floor away so that he keeps, you know, there's this natural, the muscles on the front of your body, the front of your chest and your upper back work as stabilizers to help keep this a safe pose. So pressing into your hands helps those muscles turn on and support one another. Now, for a lot of people, this is already an intense situation. If you add on the legs in plank, that adds, can add more weight into the pose. Right? And so, again, Adrian's very strong, but doing all that work and adding on the legs might actually drop the hips if he's not strong enough and would put more weight in the shoulder and the shoulder girdle, which you can see there. So again, you want to have the upper body set well, hands strong, arms hugging in, wrist pieces, whole surface of the hand. And then on top of that, you know, you want to make sure your joints stack, shoulders, thank you, Adrian, shoulders, elbows, and wrists more or less in the same line. And on top of that, think Tadasana when he comes back into his plank, right? You want to be joint stacked in your Tadasana. Right? I want the shoulders in line with the hips and the hips, even though there's a slight angle here, essentially in line with the knees and the ankles. And this subtle engagement in the low navel space, low abdominals, that doesn't overtuck the tailbone. And we don't want to really over puff the chest. We don't want the chest to press, melt towards the floor, right? We actually want to keep a little bit of that thoracic, the roundness in the thoracic spine apparent, which is all goes back to our Tadasana. And Chaturanga Dandasana, which is the push-up, the half push-up is, of course, the tail end of that, where all of that, you take all of that and bend the elbows straight back and press them down and then come through your Tri or Vinyasa. So again, it's called out a lot in classes. I teach it in a lot of my group classes. But I think you have to know in your what's happening in your, even have a sense of what's happening in your own body if you can't name it. If you're like, oh, my arms are strong, but my abdominals feel a little weak here, I'm going to bring my knees down and modify. Or I'm going to come all the way down and then take my back bend so that I take myself out of any risk. And that's a lot of injuries happen if people come in with predisposed neck, shoulder, or back issues, putting too much weight too fast with not the right amount of stabilization can cause injuries to move forward to the forefront. Okay? So that series is another one. It's important. It shows they show up a lot. It's important to know what's going on in your own body. And, you know, I say this all the time. It doesn't matter what anybody else in the class is doing, right? It matters your relationship with your body is the one that you can control to some extent. And that's where your focus should be and understanding what's happening so that you can modify. But anatomically, again, lots going on here to keep in mind. Thank you, Adrian. He's on a loop just doing this over and over. And then finally, but certainly not last, back bends, right? Again, they show up a lot. Back bends are incredibly complex poses. Some people are more flexible and they will pop into them, but it doesn't mean that there isn't a lot anatomically going on. So a couple of things to remember, and again, in the anatomy movement course, we talk about the different shapes and bones, and in back bends particularly, the different shapes of your, the different shapes of bones in the spine, the vertebrae, can inhibit or allow deeper back bends. And we never want to force a back bend. We want to make sure we're turning on what needs to be turned on correctly. And one of the things that you really, there's not enough to focus, we don't have enough time to focus on everything for back bends. But one thing I do want you to remember is that you want a neutral pelvis in a back bend. Think Tadasana again, right? We want to keep that base straight, or I should say neutral. And then the curve comes from the thoracic spine, which has the most ability to do it, right? The back bend comes from that mid spine. So we don't want, in a neutral pelvis, we want a little bit of internal rotation and a little bit of external rotation. And that's where that isometric stabilizing force comes in. So we need our glutes and our hamstrings to be working in back bends because they're helping to stabilize us. But we also need our adductors, our inner thigh muscles, to be working in the in opposition to help us not overcompress the low back. So if Adrian could grab a block and put it between his legs, this is something you can all try at home, either now or the next time you're doing a back bend, is to grab a block and just come into your half wheel, your half back bend, squeeze the block, and notice how that keeps a little bit more focus on the inner leg while still allowing your glutes and your hamstrings to do the lifting, right? And then as the back bend takes place, as it starts to lift up, you wanna focus on your feet staying. So actually, Adrian, take the block between your thighs, come on down. Take the block lengthwise, shortest end between your thighs or knees, whatever helps best, and just keep a little connection, okay, between the thighs. Press evenly into both feet, right? Squeeze the block and start to lift your hips. So see how he's staying nice and neutral. His knees and his hips are essentially in Tadasana, their joint stack, and there's that neutral space. And then as he starts to work the back bend, he wants to keep the cervical curve, right? He wants to keep that little bit of space that you see under his neck. So he's pressing into the backs of his shoulders and the back of his head. And his feet stay super strong as he hugs the block in and allows the back bend to kind of come on its own as he lifts his hips. The thing here is that at some point you're going to run into a wall, an invisible wall that says, don't go any further. And then you might say, but I can do a back bend. And then you go further. Chaos results, right? Then that's where we can have injuries happen. So all of these modifications are available to us to feel how things turn on, where we need to have points of strength, as well as mobility in the body and in each of these tricky six situations. That's the thumbnail version for sure. Thank you, Adrian.
Thank you. I love that.
Lots to think about, I'm sure. I saw a lot of people writing, so I feel, hi, Melissa, you just popped up on my screen.
So I would like us to, let me change the view here, to talk a little bit about these postures and see what everyone experienced while you were doing this this practice. I have a couple of questions myself, but how about if we go one by one? And okay. I know Claudia is there, if Claudia can also help me to manage the questions. But let's start with the beginning. Let's start with mountain pose. Does anyone have any questions that came up through mountain pose? And I'm just going to say something about mountain pose, that clear intention of honoring your body with the curves and avoid the tendency of that we grew up with always kind of scooping the tailbone, lifting the belly up. So that's something that sometimes I have to remind myself, not always I have to do that way. And one thing that I wanted to ask, Andrea, is even though we're honoring the curves of the spine in mountain pose, is it okay to, when it comes to lower back, when we're on the floor, is it okay to actually press the lower back down?
Yeah, I know we've had this conversation a few times. I do believe it is. I think because what has to happen is the abdominals have to engage to support the spine in that situation. And so that naturally happens with a little flattening. It causes a little flattening of the lumbar spine. What you don't want to do is jam it down and then overpuff the rest of the spine. You want to be able to keep that equilibrium. And that's where we start to talk as movements as nuanced and subtle versus powering down on your core or your abdominals. So yes, there's a natural little flattening in that space where you engage and keep the pelvis in a neutral space as you lift. And that happens when you're standing too, or it should happening a little bit in mountain pose to help lift the trunk. But it's not as pronounced because you don't have something behind you to stop it, right? So you that becomes that play of another thing we talk about in anatomy, I talk about in anatomy movement courses, that you know, every point in your body, every joint, every free moving joint that helps take the shape in yoga asana has both mobility and stability, and its range of motion changes from joint to joint. So kind of identifying for you, like in that instance, Adrian, what has to stay mobile and what has to become stable to allow the movement to proceed without anything happening, or preserving the movement and keeping yourself safe. So it's always that balance. And that's where, again, the study of anatomy comes in really helpful, is to really kind of understand that idea of proprioception, right? Narrowing in on that particular space and saying, if I go too much, I might over flatten, but I need just enough to tip my pelvis into a slight posterior position to help support the back then.
Now, Andrea, I have another question in regards to the arms. It was very clear to me when I was raising the arms that if I take a wider distance between my hands, it softens the shoulders. But can we draw a connection between what we individually talk on the arms and make a connection with downward dog? Because basically raising the arms in Warrior One to some extent resembles the position of the arms in downward dog, but we're working with gravity in a different way. Can you say something about what are those two differences?
Yeah, I mean, it's the same idea, right? Sometimes you may experience or see somebody that kind of dumps into their shoulders and their shoulders are up by their ears and down dog. So it's the same idea. Like you don't want to say drag your shoulders down, because that's probably not stable enough for them or might not be possible. But you want, because it is weight bearing and you're in a slightly different position, you want to make sure that everything else is adjusted well. So maybe it's a wider stance with the hands. Maybe down dog is not supposed for them right now. Maybe the feet walk in closer to take that stress out. But it comes down to the same anatomical action, where if you ask them to drag the shoulders down their back or away from their ears, they might overdo it, and it's not anatomically designed to move that way, right? But because the arms are in upward or in flexion and in up essentially, but on the floor, they're in a more fixed position, but the action stays the same.
So I did feel engagement on my upper back muscles in up and downward dog. And I want to know if that is something that we should cue to our students to look for, to activate, rhomboids, lats, traps, because I intentionally did that. And that's basically what back in the day, shoulders back in men, right? Engaging a little bit of your upper back. So I guess my question to you is, how active the upper back muscles have to be in downward dog, and how would you cue that activation if it's important
for the student? They definitely need to be active, but that's where that hugging in of the arms comes in. Because when you hug in the arms and press down, similar to what we did in plank, push the floor away, hug the arms, that automatically turns on your upper back muscles with lats, traps, and rhomboids, and those are big stabilizers there. And it feels almost like you have a hunchback, but that's okay. You know, we just don't want to melt. We don't want the heart to drop down, because what that's doing is that's putting a lot of weight on the shoulder head in down dog. But if we press down and hug in, those muscles turn on. But if you have somebody that has a very tight back, that may then put strain on the back and the low back and by extension the hamstrings. So you may have to walk their feet a little closer and bend their knees. But yes, that is, I mean, the other thing to remember with down dog, which I didn't talk about, is that you want the weight as much in the feet as you want it in the hands, in the arms, just like plank. You want to distribute the weight evenly. And based on what's happening in a particular body, you might need to make the adjustment in front or in back. But to answer your specific question, hug the arms in, press down, turn on those upper back muscles to help keep. You know, the thing about the shoulder joint and the shoulder girdle, the shoulder blades, is they're highly mobile because we use them for a lot, but they don't have a ton of stability. So we need to really power up those muscles surrounding them help them do what they need to do. So the upper back muscles are a big part of that, the rhomboids, the trap, the lats farther down.
What I'm hearing, correct me if I'm wrong, is that I feel sometimes that in yoga we put so much emphasis on the shoulders without understanding that the alignment of the shoulders depend on all the musculature around it. And so by activating the upper back, the shoulders are going to be supported. Is that something
along those lines? Yes, absolutely. And well, not only that, I mean, there's a lot of other, obviously the rotator cuff and the delts, there's a lot of other muscles that support the shoulder head. But I think a lot of people are coming in with back injuries, injuries or not enough of a strong shoulder girdle base to take that weight. And so yoga itself is not injuring you. We get injured when we don't pay attention to the cues that are in our own body and adapt to those cues. So it becomes, you know, what's happening particular to that person. But yes, your answer is a great question.
Andrea, I would like to take a few questions either from the chat or anyone wants to raise the hand in chat in just a moment. But before we go there, I'm just going to really quickly share my screen for everyone to take a look at what we have coming up with Andrea, which I'm very proud. This is our second standalone training after our Parkinson's training. So Andrea put together the Anatomy of Movement course. And this training starts on Saturday, April 15. There will be a live session on May 13 at 12 p.m. Eastern Time. The registration is now open. I'm going to drop the link again on the chat. Or if you scroll to the top of the chat, you will find that link. And Andrea, I don't know if you want to share a little bit about the training, this information on the webpage, but I think what's more interesting is this part right here.
No, I think everything is on the web page, and I think that it breaks it down pretty succinctly right there. I kind of was scrolling through the chats while you were talking, and there were a few questions that I'd love to address. Sunny had a question, which is a great question. She says, I was always taught to have the back straight in a forward fold, but recently had a physical therapist tell me to allow the back to round naturally instead. I keep hurting my low back, and that's a big part of it. Sunny, to clarify, you're hurting your back because you're keeping it straight or because you're rounding it? Not sure if Sunny is still with us. Straight, yeah. I agree with the physical therapist because it's like comes back to shifting the weight in the legs, backing up, keeping a little bending of the knees. Once that keeps the leg and the base strong, right, which are your legs and the standing forward fold, and even seated forward fold, allowing the curve of the spine to kind of naturally round and fall forward is more healthy than keeping an overly straight spine and forcing yourself into the forward fold. Right? There's still a little bit of the natural curvature there, but again, when you're in a fixed position, say in a seated forward fold, you have a little bit more grounding. And when you're in a standing forward fold, you have to play with the feet in the right. You don't want, in other words, you don't want to be too much in your heels or too much forward. You don't want to have an over straight knee. And that then the spine can kind of drape out of the pelvic girdle in a healthy way. And I would say also use props. We haven't talked about props at all in this, but I love props. I know Adrian loves props. Use as many props as you can to help support that. But I just in general, I think that I agree with your therapist. I think you have to, you can't force the spine into a position. You have to, and super straight can sometimes be forced.
I just want to be mindful of our time. So you stay a few minutes, but I just want to mention that for those who have to go, thank you so much for joining, for tuning in. If your question was not answered, please either email to us or through social media on Instagram, Warrior Flow Official, and we'll make sure that Andrea gets all the questions. However, we'll stay a few more minutes here for anyone who has any questions. And we really appreciate having you here. And remember that Andrea's training begins on April 15th. It's a self-paced training with a live session. So you will dive deeper into all the topics that we talked today. And last but not least, on June 3rd, we begin our third 200-hour yoga teacher training, that is trauma-informed. adaptive and accessible. And Andrea is with me, the lead trainer for that course. And you'll have lots of anatomy as well in there. So with that being said, Andrea, I know you have a couple of questions to answer, so go for it.
Yeah, they're coming in fast, so I don't want to skip anybody. But let's see. Carl is asking, in mountain pose, do we tend to encourage a forward flow of energy? In Carl, I would say there would be more an upward flow of energy. It's kind of that sense of equilibrium in mountain pose. When everything is stacked up, it should feel more moving up and then down and then up again, a more equal, I think, if I'm understanding your question, that the whole body is supported. See, Karen, so many poses are on your hands. I have arthritis in my wrist. Great question, Karen. I have a private client that I work with now, and she has arthritis in her wrist, and she's dealing with the same question. I know there are some wrist-free specific yoga courses out there, and I'm happy to research that for you a little bit and find them. I think chair yoga, I feel like, you know, even a version of Vinny yoga where you can still be on your legs, but, you know, lift up and fold forward and step back, use the chair, use the wall. There's many ways to take the yoga out of your wrist, but still achieve the same shape. And like I said, there's some wrist-free yoga options out there. And just shoot me an email. You guys can reach me at oneverseyoga@gmail.com if you have any questions, like Adrian just said, that we didn't get to, or it'll come through Warrior Flow. Let's see, I'm sure I missed a bunch of, oh, here, Holly, do we still need to keep, Holly may have left it, do we still need to keep the pelvis tilted anteriorly to stretch the hamstrings in the fold as you're describing? There's a little anterior tilt there, Holly. What I was talking about when Adrian was demonstrating it, we kept that little bent in the knees, and then the sit bones kind of tipped up towards the ceiling. That was a little bit of anterior tilt. So yes, you can turn that anterior tilt on and off a little bit to achieve a greater or a lesser stretch, but you want to, again, do it mindfully. Let's see. Thank you, Shelley. Shelley might have left already. Oh no, Shelley's right there. I always thought that in raising my arms, I see you, I was supposed to lift them straight up, not slightly forward. You can still lift them straight up, Shelley. But if a little bit more forward is more comfortable and feels more at ease on the shoulders, you know, see how those adjustments feel. It's just sometimes when you reach them straight up, the shoulders really, the, you know, those, what we think of as our shoulders punch up towards our ears, it can feel very congested. There is no rule of yoga law that says take your arms slightly out to the side and slightly forward to feel more comfortable in that space. Adjust the pose to fit what's going on in your body.
Thank you.
But if you're welcome, but if going straight up feels better, do it, you know, right? It's just, but you just want to be mindful. As always, I'll always say that even when I don't know things, I'm like, just be mindful. But at the end of the day, that is, I feel like, are there any kind of huge questions? Did I miss anybody that had a really important question? I feel like those were the big ones that I saw pop up. I feel like Dee, that you had a question and I skipped over it, right?
The chat, I think we've basically went through most of them.
Yeah. Dee had one that I didn't really get to. Yeah. Hi, Dee.
You answered it a little bit with the isometric movement and the stretch from the muscle of the belly of the muscle. But I was kind of wondering, I'm hearing so much about overstretching and yoga. Mm-hmm. And I think I probably am guilty of that around the hip area. And I just wondered what your thoughts were about how, and maybe how that could impact our practice on the mat, ways to kind of.
Yeah, I think it comes back. I think it comes back to knowing what to turn on and what to turn off, the mobility and stability question. And I think maybe you had put another comment down there about that. It just, overstretching happens when we don't turn on the right counter force, right? And so it's just a matter of, like, if you know what you're stretching, also know what you're turning on to stabilize stretch. So, and also make sure that you're working in all three planes of movement. Another thing we talk about in the training, planes of movement, we need to make sure we're three-dimensional creatures, right? We want to make sure that we're not overstretching. Sometimes overstretching is referring to just moving too much in one plane of action versus one plane of movement versus another. So if you're doing a lot of forward folding, make sure you're doing a lot of backward bending to some capacity that feels good. Make sure you're side stretching and twisting, rotating the spine and working the body. And then on top of that, know when you make a stretch, be familiar with what is keeping it stable, or even just know in your body what needs to stay stable for that stretch to remain healthy. I also, Pamela had a question. I'm not sure she's still here, but I remember this one kind of flying by. Pamela asked, what about feet placement and forward fold? I always feel that I should place them hip distance apart. Carrie said, I think it depends on the individual's preference. Personally, I put my feet together, but for my students, they may prefer their feet to be hip wide. I think that was the absolute perfect answer, Carrie. I agree. I think it preference, some people feel more stable with feet wide than hip together, and also injury-wise or things that are happening in your body, it might just be smarter to keep them apart so that you have a more stable base in your forward fold, especially if you have back injuries. Stenosis, anything that's scoliosis, anything that's happening in the back that changes your center of gravity or makes you feel as if your center of gravity is less than stable, feet apart is going to help you feel more stable. So thank you both.
There is for so that. Much, Andrea. I want to be mindful of our time.
Yeah.
But there's so much. I think we went all through all over the questions, and I just typed in the chat for anyone to visit our website and contact and submit any questions that you might have now. Or this is that kind of content that you finish the hour and then you start thinking and more questions will come to you later. So feel free, everyone, just to reach out to us at a later time with this. Andrea, thank you so much for the
thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me. Thank you all for being here, for asking great questions, and hopefully study more anatomy, whether it's me or somebody else.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Be well. Take care.